Then Nehemiah the governor, Ezra the priest and scribe, and the Levites who taught the people said to all the people, This day is holy to the Lord your God. Don't mourn or weep. They said this because all the people wept when they heard the words of the instruction. Go eat rich food and drink something sweet, he said to them, and send portions of this to any who have nothing ready. This day is holy to our Lord. Don't be sad, because the joy from the Lord is your strength. The Levites also calmed all the people, saying, be quiet, for this day is holy. Don't be sad. Then all the people went to eat and drink, to send portions and to have great celebration, because they understood what had been said to them. May God bless your hearing and this understanding of Scripture. This is the word of God for the people of God. You may be seated.
The moment you read in the paper that Billy Graham is dead, you'll know that he's more alive than he's ever been before, and I'm in paradise. And I'm looking forward to it.
The mark he made for the gospel, for the good news, for Jesus, is unprecedented. What a life well lived.
Well, he's one of the most important Christian evangelists who ever drew breath.
Now, you can't change your past, but Christ can change your past.
I can only imagine.
God, I'm certain, is with me, and when I come to the moment of death, I believe that at that moment, there's going to be an angel that will take me by the hand and usher me into the presence of the Lord. And I'm going to be in His presence, and it's going to be the most peaceful, the most wonderful, the most thrilling moment that I have ever experienced.
God has sent me out as a warrior.
I can only imagine.
On the five continents to preach the gospel.
What my eyes will see when your face.
That's the way to God, pursue Jesus.
Is before me. I can only imagine.
When you go home tonight, you don't go alone. Christ is with you. He loves you.
Surrounded by your glory, one will my heart feel when I dance for you, Jesus. Oh, in all of you be still.
He was the spiritual conscience of our country.
Thank you for the integrity of a man who backed it up in every kind of a way.
Let's talk about 9/11 first. 2001, you're in the White House. What happened, Carl?
Well, Tim Gabe line events, but two of my deputies were in charge of the service at the National Cathedral, and they suggested that Billy Graham be asked to participate, and he readily agreed. The difficulty was we had to get him to Washington, D.C., and on that morning of that service, one civilian aircraft was in the skies above the United States.
We should remind everybody that aircraft have been grounded all across the country at that point.
One civilian aircraft is in the skies above the United States and bears full
glory. He died on the cross so that all the sins you've ever committed, all the things you've ever done wrong, are forgiven. What do you have to do? You have to repent of your sins.
I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I do is forever worship you. I can only imagine.
This is a joyful, godly man. I want to just say thank you, God. You blessed this generation with a man whose heart was sold out to you.
Thank you.
gospel, yes, without the name Billy Graham coming up.
He didn't stop with his generation.
I can only imagine. And all I do is forever worship.
There's been nobody like this man, probably ever in the history of mankind. And to watch people respond to the message, pretty overwhelming. Every single night.
I can only imagine.
God would like to be remembered as a person who was faithful to God and faithful to my call and did it with integrity and with love.
I'm going to ask you to do something that we've seen thousands of people do all over the world. I'm going to ask you to make a commitment tonight to be sure that you know Christ and that you're ready for eternity.
Well, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
A good sunny day. And as our video showed, you know, we lost a giant in the world. I mean, Billy Graham was a giant in the religious community, a true brother, for sure, in Christ. And all of us here have been impacted by Billy's life, whether you know it or not. Billy Graham has impacted your life. And I encourage you to maybe pull out a book and get a book and read about Billy's life. And more importantly, try to mimic a lot of the things that he did because he lived a tremendous devoted life to Christ. Literally millions and millions of people come to Christ through Billy Graham. So, I mean, the tribute to him was worth every second of it because he's an amazing figure for all of us to know what it looks like to pick up your cross and follow Christ. He definitely did that. Last week, we kicked off a series called Remarkable. You can see it there. Identified as extraordinary, focusing on five marks of a Methodist. And part one of that message last week was A Methodist Loves God. And if you missed that message, on our website is a study guide for this entire message that I put together, which includes all the manuscripts, everything that we went through as far as the sermon goes, all the videos that we used, every bit of it, plus the gospel readings or the Bible readings for every day of the week from one week to the next. So I encourage you to use that study guide, and you can listen to the message from last week on that source as well as on our app. So those two great resources to do that. But I want to start this morning, you know, really focusing on the title of this message, which is A Methodist Rejoices in God. And so I'm going to ask, Ed's going to walk around with a mic, and we're going to ask a few of you, what's been some of the most joyful occasions you've had in your church experience? And it doesn't necessarily have to be this church. It could be just your experience as a whole. So Glenn, you're back. Why don't you kick us off? What's some of your most joyous occasions in your church experience and throughout your life?
Well, I think it's been awful nice to be have Easter breakfast, and the men all get together and cook the meat before, and we don't have to have a lot of committees like women do. We just got in there and got it done, and that was something that was really good for me.
Awesome. Larry, how about you? You're right across the aisle.
I guess becoming a member of this church and becoming a part of the membership and the fellowship of this church when I joined. It's been a remarkable experience since I've been here.
Fantastic. Missy, why don't you share some with us?
Boy, you're putting me on the spot.
I'll put you on the
spot. Actually, I think the best part of this church is the kids. I learn something just from them every Sunday.
Amen. You got a few applauses there. Good Ralph, while you're right there.
Getting married and seeing my kids, my children, and my grandchildren be baptized.
Awesome. Ed, why don't you share something?
Oh, I don't know. I guess just the family that is in this church, and not just, I don't just mean aunts and uncles. I mean family that you can't explain.
Yeah. Amen. Okay. Hey.
I can remember I was privileged enough to go to Billy Graham Crusade in Kansas City when I was like 14 or 15.
Wow.
And I can still remember how that spoke to my heart. So it was really special.
Amen. Awesome. Who else? Jim.
Well, when I was having heart surgery and so forth, this family came together and brought me food and helped me financially. And that was the most moving thing for me, because I felt like part of this family, but that showed me that they really, that you all really cared. And I am truly moved by it. I wanted to thank you, but that is the most joyous time of my life, to knowing that I'm held up and special to you all. Thank you.
Thanks, Jim. Well, we get over here, Brownie.
Well, I grew up in this church, and there's a lot of special moments, but watching my sons get baptized was a pretty joyous occasion.
Fantastic. Gail?
I think directing the choir and watching the Holy Spirit work through the voices for years and years and years, I truly enjoyed it.
Awesome. And why don't we hit a couple more on this side, and then we'll roll it in. Susan, how about Susan?
Gosh, I remember a lot of the years. One of the funnest parts of the year and the most joyful was the Lord's Acre Sale. As kids, we always look forward to that. And coming to Sunday school, and then later getting to teach Sunday school.
Awesome. Can't forget Pat. I wish you could see her face. She just went.
Well, I think growing up in this church, and I have gone to other churches, but there's nothing like coming back home.
Amen. All right. And right there, Abby. Let's get Abby in there. Thanks for volunteering, Abby.
She said the day Matt and I were watching him at daycare, she broke her arm.
That's your most joyous memory?
Oh, it's a good memory. You're not going to forget it.
Go, Matt.
I said
one. Go ahead,
watching my daughter and Luke's kids when they got dedicated in the church.
All right, well, we've got to grab one of them pumpkin bushes. We can't lift them up, and we'll call it a day.
When I was really young, I came to Bible school here. That was my most enjoyable time during Bible school. I had all of my, made all my crafts and everything. I really enjoyed that. That's one thing that brought me back.
All right. Thanks, everybody, for sharing. But that's really our message today. As a Methodist rejoices in God, and that's what we're called to do, is rejoice. Does anybody here know Yiddish? Anybody know Yiddish? Ever take Yiddish? All right. Well, this is a Yiddish proverb. It says, what soap is to the body, laughter is to the soul. And so think about that for a minute. Another way humor has been defined is, humor is a gentle way to acknowledge human frailty. And I love that definition of humor, because I think that's really the case, especially if we heal from our past. Not everybody here today is laughing at their past or laughing at themselves. Maybe they're not laughing at all because they got something going on in their life. They may have some pain, some hurt, some hang up going on in their life that's really got them blocked off from being at this place. So we want to get to that place. Ultimately, that is the goal. And humor is a healthy thing. Be able to laugh and really have true joy in your life is tremendous. But humor can also be done improperly. We can use humor as a defense mechanism. I know probably, especially in my younger years, humor and sarcasm was a way to defend myself. It was a way to keep you at bay. You know, so I use humor throughout my life. I know in periods, in a very negative way, not really what it was called. And it's really not called humor when you go that far with it. We see this a lot on late night television with our TV hosts, you know, and the way they tear down people, whether it's political figures or movie stars or whoever was the most viral internet feed of the week on social media, whatever they like, and just take that person, whoever he or she is, and try to create humor out of it. But sometimes it becomes darn right evil, and it's hard to even watch some of that stuff anymore. But humor is a way of saying I'm okay, it's a way of saying I'm not okay. It's a way of saying that you're not okay, but that's okay, right? At the end of the day. And if we're believers, we can say, add this to the end of that phrase, which is, he loves us anyway. He loves us just the way we are. And it's okay to have some humor. Even Billy Graham, in his great way he preached and the way he was so forceful with the scripture and doctrine, still had a sense of humor. So let's check out Billy in his humor.
I know that we're near the end of this conference, and some of you may be wondering,
why they have a speaker from the field of religion. Richard can answer that because he made that decision. But some years ago, I was on an elevator in Philadelphia coming down. I was to address a conference at a hotel. And on that elevator, a man said, "I hear Billy Graham is staying in this hotel." And another man looked in my direction and said, "Yes, there he is. He's on this elevator with us." And this man looked me up and down for about 10 seconds. And he said, "My, what an anticlimax." But I was on an airplane in the East some years ago. And the man sitting across the aisle from me was the mayor of Charlotte, North Carolina. His name is John Belt. Some of you would probably know him. And there was a drunk man on there. And he got up out of his seat two or three times, and he was making everybody upset by what he was trying to do. And he was slapping the stewardess and pinching her as she went by. And everybody was upset with him. And finally, John Belt said, "You know who's sitting here?" And the man said, "No." He said, "It's Billy Graham, the preacher." He said, "You don't say." And he turned to me and he said, "Put her there." He said, "Your sermons have certainly helped me." And I suppose that that's true with thousands of people.
So that's pretty funny. And Bill could laugh at himself. He had that joy about him, and that's what we're called to do, is to have that same joy. And so hopefully we get to a place where we can associate our religious life, our church life, you know, with fun and celebration. John Wesley himself said, "A Methodist rejoices in God." That's one of the marks of a true Methodist. In Wesley's translation of the Beatitudes in Matthew 5, he switches the word blessed with the word happy, and I think that's an awesome interpretation. That, you know, really realizing that God created us for us to enjoy him and to get the most out of life. And that's really what we're called to do. An author named Hannah Whitall Smith described the Christian secret of a happy life that it isn't superficial, and that joy is a comprehensive response we make with our whole beings to God's love in our life. So it's a response, you know, and it's an important response that we have this joy, that we experience it hopefully sometime in our life and sometime on this journey. The author of our book, Steve Harper, he quotes, he says, "Just as fingerprints make a unique and unrepeatable sons and daughters of God, we are given a distinctive soul purpose, not just the life of God in the human soul, but the life of God in our soul. But it's the anxieties, the depressions, it's the resentments, it's focusing on past mistakes, it's focusing on trials from the past that can block us off from experiencing this joy that God's called us to have. I mean, we should be truly happy, joyous, and free as believers. But sometimes we're going through a loss. We've heard about losses this morning. Sometimes we're hurting. But joy doesn't deny grief, and that's an important thing to know. We can go through grief, you know, whether it's a loss of life or it's a setback for our health. Regardless of the situation, it's healthy to grieve. It's okay to cry. It's okay to have this process in our life lingering in our heart. But the ultimate deal is we can do it with joy. Joy is a lot different than happy, being happy. You know, joy is a permanent place that we get to. And we have joy because we know we're forgiven for our sins from yesterday, today, and tomorrow. We know we're going to have eternal life. We know we're going to be reunited with those people that went before us. And that's something that we need to keep in the forefront of our mind and think about often. But through that joy and through our life and working through the difficulties, the hurts, habits, and hang-ups that come in our life, we get to a place, hopefully, where we can laugh. And laughter is spiritual. I mean, I can't tell you how powerful it is to be able to truly laugh. And I would just ask you a question. When's the last time that you really had a good belly laugh? I mean, where your sides was about ripped out. You know, I mean, one of those good old laughs. Well, a friend of ours, Susie and I, a good friend of mine named Barkley. Barkley lives in Nashville, Tennessee. And Barkley is a stand-up comic. He worked for years on Hee Haw. He was a producer. He helped produce Hee Haw. He was that guy, when he did live Hee Haw, he was the guy that came out and opened the show. Hey, everybody! And got everybody all excited and wrapped up. He was that guy. The last several years, Barkley's been a school teacher. He teaches television production in Nashville. And not too many years ago, he was voted the Teacher of the Year. And President Obama came in and gave him the award for that honor. So he's had a lot of success in his life. But he's a great friend of ours. But he's really, really funny. So on our men's retreats, Bart and I share a lot of spiritual paths together. And on our men's retreats, several years ago, he introduced this laughing meditation. Now, some of you, I can promise you, nobody's ever done a laughing meditation, but he introduced it one morning at breakfast with about 150 guys. He said, "We're going to do a laughing meditation this morning." And so we were all skeptical of it. But I can promise you, 5 minutes later, you know, we all needed stitches in our sides because our ribs blew out. So I asked Barker, I told him the message I was doing. I said, "Barker, will you create a laughing meditation for us?" He said he would be glad to. So he spoke actually at a rehab the other night. He was doing a spiritual talk at a rehab. And he got their permission to videotape it. Anyway, he shot this video just for us, doing a laughing meditation live with this group of guys. So he's going to walk us through this. But the key part of this is I want you to be involved in it. So as he's walking us through this, I want you to engage and follow his steps. And I can promise you in the next 2 minutes, you will be in stitches. So enjoy this exercise, participate in it, and you're going to have a lot of fun.
Is it my belief that laughter, when I'm laughing with you, God is in the room. God's right there. And when I'm laughing with you, God is with us. Come on in, man. Come on in. Sorry. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're just going to start off, and it really is, we're just going to do a little bit of laughing. I know it's weird as heck, but are you willing to go with me? Okay, so we're going to start off, and it's just somebody just told you a cute little joke, okay? Here you're gonna go. So what we're gonna do is this is a pretty good joke, right? This is a pretty darn good joke, right? So I know it's weird as heck. All right, so now, what we're going to do is we're going to get in touch with our inner laugh, all right? And this is like somebody, so you're looking at the camera and you see this head, another camera like, okay, ready? And here we go.
Okay to laugh at things like that in a big way. So I don't know where you're on in your spiritual journey. I don't know when's the last time you've had a good laugh, or even if you can laugh in your life. But I hope you get to a place where you can just truly, one, not take yourself so seriously, but just laugh and enjoy your life, enjoy your faith, enjoy sharing the gospel with others, enjoy each other in community when you get together. Just have fun, enjoy it. There's some great takeaways from today. And one is, you know, a Methodist rejoices in God. That's one of the most important things. We should be able to look at our life and it should be just evidence there that we rejoice in God in everything we do. Whether it's listening to praise music, whether it's singing, whether it's dancing, anything and all the things we do, dramatics that we do inside the church, we should rejoice in that and have fun. Our lesson from Nehemiah that Brownie read for us today. You know, in Nehemiah and the book of Ezra, they go hand in hand. And Nehemiah was appointed to be the governor of this particular area that he went to, and his job was to go into this area and rebuild Jerusalem. And he went there and he met a resistant crowd, a crowd that didn't want to
they were kind of whining and complaining, and he got them to turn around. And in 52 days, they rebuilt the wall in Jerusalem. But this is really the message that came out of it. We were reminded in Scripture to quit whining and count it all joy for everything God has blessed us with. We're all been blessed in a million ways. We are to eat and drink and enjoy and share our food and drink with others and get praise for it each and every time we do. We just got to be joyful about everything we have. I mean, from a glass of water to a full-blown meal, we should be grateful for what God has given us, and we should rejoice in that. Joy is going to come from living an other-centered life, right? Not a self-centered life. When my buddy Henry says it great, my life is great as long as I'm not involved in it. You know, when I'm involved with other people's life and invested in other people and not worried about my deal, my life never gets any better than that place. So I encourage us all to really focus that, take inventory of that in our own life. We can express joy through worship, prayer, and interactions with others. So there's ways we can have fun. You know, we did a little bit of that today, but we can just have fun with each other. We can laugh. We heard a lot of people share about how they've had fun throughout their church and religious life, and it's been awesome. Joy is a response to God's grace, the means of grace. So many means of grace that we participate in as Methodists in our church ritual. And it's evidence that we are living as followers of Jesus Christ if we have a joyful life. You know, our Christianity, our faith should be contagious. Where people go, man, I want what that guy's got. I want what she has in my life. I want that kind of faith for my life. And we must remember Rule 63, which is don't take yourself too darn seriously. And Rule 62, which is to have fun. You know, and a couple takeaways from Billy Graham. We know that Billy Graham was a champion for the Lord. And we are encouraged to be champions for the Lord, too, by finding a way to share joy with somebody this week. So that's my encouragement, and that's my challenge to you. Who can you share your joy with this week? Who can you reach out to that needs a little bit, a shot of hope, or, you know, in their life, that needs a little bit of uplifting? That's what we want to try to do. And lastly, Billy reminds us, each and every one of us, that God loves us truly and wholeheartedly, and that's the truth. And that's something that we should really get joy in. Can I get an amen? We should really give praise that God loves us. He created us to enjoy him. He created us to have a relationship with him. And we just need to get out of the way of ourselves and invite and embrace that relationship. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your time today. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your gift of joy, a joy that comes through your son who paid it all for us at the cross so that we can have freedom from the bondage of self, freedom from sin, that we are truly forgiven for our sins of yesterday, today, and tomorrow, that we can go through life having great joy in our life and giving praise and gratitude just for those truths in our life, that you set us free, a freedom that hopefully we can all be in touch with, because if we're truly free, we're going to have joy, and with it's going to come happiness, and with it, from that, it's going to come laughter. We're able to laugh at ourselves, we're able to laugh at others along the way, looking back at our lives, the mistakes we made, some of the poor choices, but we heal from those things. And we learn to laugh. Not only laugh at those, but we learn to use those as assets to help other people along the way. But Lord, we just want to give you all the praise for that. We want to give you the praise for the music, the songs, the dances, everything that we do to show honor to you. We pray that in a big way, we can always remember why we're doing those things. Why we come to church on Sunday, why we sing songs, why we read scripture. It's all for us to grow closer to you and give praise to you so we can have the ultimate joy and ultimately go out into the world to make disciples for Christ, to help transform the world, but ultimately to bring joy to the world. And all God's people agreed and said, amen. All right.